going to stand in the gap and we're going to stand in for our nation and for the deception. We don't want our country to be another Zimbabwe. We definitely don't want that. And that's what the enemy has had in mind. And the previous leader was specifically assigned to try and take us to totally destroy everything that there was that was good in this nation. We do not allow that. We will not allow that. This country belongs to our God. And Jesus died for our nation. And so we're going to cry out for the African nations that the Lord will really break through. But also remember that all the survivors that are here are also internationally linked. So it's a whole network over the nations. And Doug did a very good message that he preaches on the veil over the nations. That scripture in Isaiah that speaks about there is a veil, like a whole web, satanic web that's been thrown over the nations, where Satan has captured the survivors. They are prisoners, and he hides behind them, and he uses them, and specifically within the church, because they're born again. But we'll go through all of that, and we'll explain it nicely to you. So now we've come to the advanced training in DID SRA, and we want to understand how do we actually do the interviews. We want to understand, we're going to go to the inside at the very base of the DID structure. The system of every individual has core beliefs that maintain dissociation. So that's where the conflict is, right at the very base. There's dividedness, DID, and it's these conflicts. Remember Hegelian dialect that we spoke about? And that's what keeps the DID in place. These core beliefs were adopted and formed during trauma. In other words, when they take them through near-death experiences and they do these terrible things to them, the survivor themselves, their little mind, start to believe things that get told to them, you are bad, it's your fault. The other day, just to give you an example, I was praying with a lady from Europe, and she had the strong lesbian stuff that we were dealing with. And she was also raised by Nephilim, and she was in a cave, and they would bring this lady every now and then, and she would connect with her. So she bonded with this woman, because you cannot be with hybrids day and night. I mean, they're not human. They are not human. They would bring this woman and come and spend a little bit of time, and then this woman would go, but she bonded with her. And you know, the cult, anything you bond with, whether it's an animal or a human, they will eventually kill to cause more trauma. So she bonded with her, and they were in this cave. She was tiny, and the cult made her believe that this lady stood at the edge of the cave, and she held on tight with everything she had as a tiny little girl, holding on to this lady, and this woman fell out the cave and fell to her death. And they told her, it's your fault. You couldn't hold on tight enough. It's you. You're the one that killed her. And that's a core belief. That's a core belief. She believes she's bad, she's evil, she's not good enough. So all of that stuff gets put into the core. That's part of what I'm saying here. Right in the core there, in the very center of the being, they have core beliefs which were adopted or spoken or whispered into them or told, like this girl, you weren't strong enough. Then I said, okay, let's ask the Lord Jesus, what's the truth? What's the truth? What really happened there? Because remember, they trick little children. They tricked you. So let's find out what was the trick. And so we waited. We said, Lord Jesus, come and show her the truth. And then this little part spoke up and she said, but I wasn't strong enough. I could not hold her. And the bad guys threw her down. And so immediately she saw what the truth was, and the lie was broken. You see, it was broken, and she was released right in the core of believing that lie, what they had put into her. So this is what you're going to be finding all the time. It's a core belief, believing I'm not good enough and I was bad. So they influence how an individual relates to themselves, to the world, to God, and to others. So you know the whole thing about a belief system, even for us normal people. We also believe lies. If we just go through normal trauma, growing up in a home where you get rejected and abused and all the rest, you do believe the lies, and it's to break the lie, but you've got to find out what do they believe, what was the lie that was put inside. Okay, so I just did a little bit of a diagram. Inside of every survivor, you've got core beliefs, which is what drives them, their belief system. It's what they believe about themselves. I'm bad, I'm just not good enough, I can't be accepted. All of these lies that's inside. Then on the next layer, you've got around the core beliefs that's anchoring everything together. You've got bonds with Satan and hybrids. That's encapsulating the belief, the core belief system. You've got the incest bond, which is with the father. Now, we're going to talk about different scenarios. You would have this little girl lying on the altar, the baby, and then there are a whole lot of fathers that stand around the altar. And then the whole thing is that the biological father is the one that starts to sexually abuse the child. So that baby from at birth already goes through a three-way sex assault, which is vaginal and anal and the mouth. What they would do is they build a whole system around this, and they repeat this assault on their lives. And then we look at new births just now, they do the same thing. And they repeat this, the three-way sex. They repeat because what they would do with that little baby, they would separate the vagina part, which is pleasure, and they would place that under a domain of, say, Nimrod, which is pleasure. Then the sodomy, which is the anal part, the beast, they would put that under Apollyon, the destroyer. So there's your anal sex. So they separate the vagina. This sounds hectic, doesn't it? Our normal minds, you're thinking, what on earth are they doing? But this is how sick Satan's mind is and how he really tried to bring such split in the person created in God's image. So the vagina part will be the pleasure part. The anal sex is very painful, and the sodomy side, and that's the beast, the dog, that whole thing with the dog and the beast, and they create a beast inside of you. You get so degraded, you don't believe you're a human anymore. So it's tough. It's not easy to face the truth, and it's quite a journey to be able to deal with that deep pain. But just to say to you that in the past, when somebody would start to manifest, we want to go into war, they could be in a memory right then. Joseph Mengele put them in cages. And he had a house where he did the programming right there near where Doug's staying now in Syracuse. And what they would do is they would put these girls into the cages and treat them like dogs. And he was trying to create the beast in them. That's how they would create the beast. And they'd be naked, they'd be dirty, they'd be stinking. It's like lower than a dog. They treat them worse than you treat an animal that is being abused. Because he tried to kill the humanity. He tried to destroy whatever was human within a person. And to create this domain under Apollyon, who's the destroyer, who feels nothing, who's like an animal and that will just kill. When they cued, they'll kill and feel nothing. That's the whole thing. That's what he tried to create. So he creates this beast, and they do it on hands and knees, and they have leashes around their necks, and then they get sodomized the whole time. This is ongoing. And so they create this domain of being the beast. But to get to that level is quite hard work. You don't just get there quickly, because it's the most conflicted inside of them. Can you imagine? To think you've been an animal in a cage, lower than a dog. You've been treated, you've been dirty, you so self-despise. Can you imagine how far away you have pushed that? You don't just get there. To get to the domain of the beast and Apollyon the destroyer is part of the deepest work. You don't just get there easily because it's so gruesome. It's really so terrible. I was so thankful for Connie. And you know, when you're in a situation, you learn. And that's what made me stop to just jump in with warfare when there's an abreaction to say, wait, she's in a memory state. Now, can you imagine if I'd gone into warfare there, I would have traumatized her even more. Do you know what I'm saying? In the name of Jesus, we bind you this. So what is she feeling? I mean, she's in her most degraded place, dropping on her hands and knees, waiting to be sodomized. It's terrible, terrible to think what these people go through. And it's to read where these people are and in their memory states. You know, when they abreact, it's like they feel they're in the cage now. They get food thrown at them. And they got to eat raw meat and tear it off the bones just like an animal. That's how these little children were raised. Doug.
In the deepest core state, preverbal, nonverbal, they will speak through their body position, body language. And when they're in that, they don't have a voice, they don't have understanding, they need to be validated. You're a human. Open your eyes. See where you are now. Transition. Get in ground in the present. I command it in the Jesus Christ name. Everything that makes you look and feel like a beast, I command to leave. What cannot leave, I bless you in Jesus' name. Open your eyes. Come forward. Keep working and grounding. Just completely in an abreactive state. And they gradually settle down. Look around. See what you're wearing. You're not naked anymore. There's no blood. Keep grounding, and they finally transition out of the past into the present.
That's
it. Takes grounding.
That's good. That's what I really appreciate with this other way that God has taught, the quicker way. Instead of going into all the warfare and da-da-da, binding and whatever, where she's not in the past. Remember, she's not in the cage. In her mind, she's in the cage. She can't speak. She can't tell you. This is a 65-year-old woman. Guys, it was so painful to see it. You just start weeping because you just see where she's come from. She's now in a child state, in the cage, and she's waiting to be sodomized. And she's way back. But as Doug said, as you start calling her forward, because remember time and space. Remember, I've talked a lot on time and space. Those of you that heard my teaching on time and space. The enemy works a lot on time and space. She was in time and space. She was way back in the cage. She was a tiny little one. So what do? We call her back into this time and into this space. And we say, listen, it's the 22nd of July, 2018. Look at your hands. Doug always says, look at your hands. You're not small anymore. You don't have paws. You got hands. Look, and you ground her. Look at the clothes. And you take them through a whole process of bringing them into this time and into this space, and you break that thing. It was so amazing just to see God do this and to see the work that instead of the old way, bringing it into understanding and bringing them into this time and space and letting them look at the clothes. I'm not naked. I'm not dirty. I bless you. You're not an animal. Being able to read what's going on and then to speak life to them. And that thing is broken. She comes out of that. And then you can start to help her and deal with that domain. Many times when they abreact, many times when it's little children. Now, if I would keep her as a little child in the cage and keep on talking, where's the little girl in the cage? The little girl that believes she's a beast. The little girl that believes she's a dog and she's going to be sodomized. And I keep talking there. I keep the DID in place. Do you see the mistakes that we've made in the past? And how we as counselors, through ignorance, how we've kept DID in place. So you've got the incest bond with the father, who is the first one that will come and bring that incest bond. There's the three-way sex. So they do the anal sex, and they separate that, and they do the vaginal sex, and say that's the pleasure. And the anal sex is the pain, so they separate pain and pleasure. And they build on those foundations for years and years and years and years. You've got the vaginal sex and the anal sex. Then they come with the mouth, with the oral sex, and they choke the baby to death. That's the first death experience with a penis in the mouth. And when they go through that memory, it's like, and they're trying to cough and they're trying to get this thing out their mouth. And it's very, very, very scary. And they go through their death experience and they're resuscitated and they repeat this. So how do they do that? Now listen, at birth, this is done, three-way sex. And they put them to death. It used to be those that would report 18 months, 17 months, 15 months. They would be drawn out, a scripture read to them. Because remember, Satan knows. He wants their neshama. What is the neshama part? What is the glory? What happened when he fell out of heaven? What did he lose? He lost the glory of the Lord. Now he knows the only way he can get back glory is to capture it, to steal it. So he has to lead that little one to Jesus. Because the minute the spirit of that little one joins with God's spirit, the glory is there. So it's what we would say born again experience. But it's this tiny little one, now that more and more survivors have come forward and more things have opened up, they've come to an age of 13 months. 13 months where they draw the spirit of the little one out, tell them about Jesus, tell them, but would you like to know Jesus? Would you want to give your heart to Jesus? And of course, every little one, yeah, small as what they are, and remember, you're speaking to their spirit, not their intellect. As they get drawn out, that little one gives their heart to Jesus, and that's where they get to know the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And they can see, remember, they can x-ray you. These guys are very sharp in the spirit, and Satan knows, and so they x-ray. And the minute the spirit of that baby connects with the spirit of God, and the glory is restored through being born again, as we know it, the glory is there. Immediately, when that has happened, they would bring in a false Jesus. And they would then rape the child and do the three-way sex again at new birth. We call that new birth identity. So at new birth identity, because that is the key of all the ministry, of all the therapy that you're going to do with the DID SRA, is you want to go and you want to release and unwrap the grave clothes from the new birth identity. You've got this little one who's now just filled with the glory of God, the light of God. And what does Satan do? He's after that. He's after that light. Immediately the child gets put into death. Child gets to go through the three-way sex again. It's a tiny little one. Now remember, although the body is growing, what they do is they regress. So they regress them back. Now it's new birth, 13 months. But they will go back and regress and take from birth. Remember, they can move up and down. It's spirit. What we're doing here is spirit. So they will regress, go back to birth, where it was this tiny baby, the first assault with the biological father. And many times, that's what's coming forward now, is that it was Hitler. That's actually the biological father, so they have the daughter of Hitler.
For a long time, we knew that the birth identity, which is fallen, they're dead. And so at new birth, they obviously take them back to that original foundational experience with a biological father or that which represents a biological father. Hitler lived until 62, so anyone who's programmed by Mengele, it will be Hitler there as the father doing this, okay? But now we know that all of that, on a corporate level, goes beyond the birth identity back to a corporate event that happened in 1945 in Jerusalem with Hitler, Mengele, the fathers, the biological fathers, Joseph Collins, who is the convergence of the 13, King George VI. And so there's a corporate conception. So every mother that will conceive a hybrid was conceived simultaneously in Jerusalem, 1945, with an ancient one, a hybrid, sodomizing Hitler, sodomizing King George VI, at the conception of every single woman that will be a breeder. And that conception, you say, well, how's that possible? If you're asking that, you'll stop there and stay there the rest of your life while the rest will go on, okay? These are conceived, and their conception identity is frozen in a cryogenic chamber or whatever they do, and then they're released sequentially throughout life, placed in different surrogate wombs, so that their corporate identity is enmeshed in their spirit with everyone else. So you have to get their corporate identity out. With Connie, I don't want to be corporate. I just want to be a person. Well, you're going to have to let yourself go in there. And when you become a corporate person, you have no sense of a body, because that's before implantation, and you get all that life essence back. You allow that to become corporate and call that forward in the body, and then that neshama is restored and separated from everyone else's or the human spirit. So it is corporate. Now, this is overwhelming, I realize. But you know, God has it in hand. I would be dead if it wasn't for the Lord. So I'll just stop there. But it's this corporate domain between conception and implantation. It's the womb of Apollyon, the womb of Anastasia. And as that life essence is separated out from everyone else's life essence and able to come forward and be present, more of that new birth identity is being released into the present. And it's not a part. It's life essence coming out of death into life.
Okay. Everybody's still okay. All right. So you've got the incest bond and the three-way sex. And they keep on repeating that process. But although today, say they're 45 years old, but they want to do a ritual, the day before they see Doug, they normally get taken out the night before, and off they go, and they will then be taken through a ritual. When they do the ritual, they call out the birth identity and the new birth identity. In other words, they regress them back. Although it's a grown-up body, it's like they're doing it to a little one, because they're reinforcing what happened years and years ago to the tiny baby. So everything is around the tiny baby. And then they do the three-way sex again, and they would be punished by a false Doug Riggs. There's a false Doug Riggs around. Anyone working in this field that is doing damage to their kingdom, they will clone you. The survivors will say, but I saw you at a ritual. You hurt me. I've had places where I've been teaching, and then they come to me, the survivors would say, please can I look at your eyes? And then they come and they look up to me, and then they look at me, and then they say, okay, you're the good Amanda, you're not the bad Amanda. Because there's a bad Amanda that is very, very cruel, that hurts them. This is very real. They are trying to trick them, they're trying to stop them from coming to therapy. They're putting lies out there in the church world against Nephilim, against all of the stuff, to stop people from coming free and from getting to know this knowledge. It's So you've got the incest bond with a father is a big one because of always regressing them back and doing the three-way sex. And then you've got what Doug's just explained now is the enmeshment with the other SRAs. They always work in a network. And that whole thing is where they go through cross-programming. If you're working with one SRA, they're not just on their own. You touch one here in South Africa and the whole network across the nations, because they are all connected. In the beginning, the old days, we used to speak about the spider queen and the spider network. And you know, you touch a thread of a spider web, there is this whole vibration throughout. And they would then come running to reinforce and try and see if they can stop this deliverance from taking place. What Doug was explaining here is that what we found with the top bloodlines, the royal bloodlines, the 13 top bloodlines, is these girls are reporting now, and it's from different nations. They are not in connection with each other. They don't even know about each other. But what we have found out is that they were all conceived at the same time. In other words, Anastasia, have you listened to Romanov and the history of the Russians? Now, it's interesting how South Africa is linked with the Russians as well. But we had the Russians, and then we had this whole massacre. Remember the massacre of how they were all wiped out? That's what Google tells you, and they say, no, all the Romanovs were destroyed. They kept Anastasia. She was 16 years old. They kept her alive. And around her, because of her bloodline, because of her iniquity force that she'd been carrying, they then harvested her eggs and they impregnate. The conception took place. So there's conception. And as Doug explained, they froze them. Now, these are a whole lot of sisters, little sisters, and there was a brother, and we're going to show you the picture and tell you the story about the brother and how they were all in Anastasia's womb. All of them are going back to Anastasia's womb. There is a universal womb that is carrying Satan's plan. And then you have the wombs of the woman that are connected to the big womb and worshipping this is a whole goddess fertility thing, worshipping this Anastasia. So they all report that they've been in Anastasia's womb. When were you conceived? 1945. You know, that's ages ago. They found that they can have frozen embryos for 20 years and then they can implant them and they're still a baby. This is what they are bringing out into the open now. All of these babies are conceived from Anastasia's womb. Then they get frozen. And then at certain times, they would pick these little babies out of their frozen state. Now, when you start ministering to these royals that are part of that whole project, this is the Genesis 6 project of today. When you would start ministering to them, suddenly they get cold. Oh, I want a blanket. And it's not cold. But they all got blankets around them and it's the memory of the frozen state. They would take that frozen baby and they would plant it into a surrogate family in Germany, in Austria, wherever in the East, all over the world. At a certain time, they would then implant, they carefully chose the surrogate family and they would plant this precious, precious baby. I mean, you don't just do stupid things with this. I mean, this is really precious for Satan. And you would plant this then into a surrogate mother who would then carry the child and the child would be born into this family. But what they would also do is then they would come for that child and take the child to Jerusalem and the child would be staying with Nephilim and they would be swapping them in and out because it's not always just one baby that is conceived. They can have four babies that look exactly the same. Like with Dan, we'll get to Dan's story. They would program them and then take them back to the family. And then all they remember is they had a normal family life. They went to school here. They get given pictures. They get given a photo album and told, this is your life story. I don't know if you watched on my webpage. I posted a young man's testimony. His name is Nathan. And it's snatched from the fire. You must watch it. It is brilliant. Young man telling his story. You know, you don't get many men talking. But this young man is telling his story and he says he was given a photo album by his mother to say, this is your life story. This is how you were raised. This is what happened. And it's all little pictures to try and build the presenter life to say you were normal. You were fine. But his memories are all starting to come forward now and he's realizing what has really been going on in the background. So we're so grateful for this young man that's actually speaking and telling his story. You can check it on my webpage, the story of Nathan. snatched from the fire. That's his website. What you then have here are all the little girls that were in Anastasia's womb that are different ages. They're all sisters that were conceived at the same time, but they weren't implanted at the same time. Do you hear what I'm saying? So conception took place all at the same time, but then they were frozen and they were put into wombs in different countries. Now these sisters are meeting each other. It's amazing. As they are coming out and things are being exposed, you have younger ones and you have older ones, and they are actually all connected. And they were all part of Hitler's program. Now that Doug read yesterday, what Hitler said, we're going to design something before my death. And it happened before his death. He put this all in place so that there would be an antichrist, everything anti-God, anti-Jesus, in the place of, because he's now the savior. He's now coming to save the world. So this is the whole enmeshment. And that is what Doug was saying. You've got to separate them out from one another because their souls and their spirits are so intertwined and connected. And so to be able to get free from the universal womb of Anastasia and the universal plan of the Genesis 6 project, you've got to do the separation so that their neshama can return and they're not part of the project anymore. Because Satan hides behind the stolen glory that he takes from these survivors. Okay, so we see here that these things hold everything in place that we've just spoken about. They shield the core. Everything about the hybrids and Satan and the enmeshments, everything shields the core. So you're not going to just easily get to the core. All right, you're not just going to easily walk in and get to the core. It's shielded. And then from the core, all of the stuff that we talk now is busy energizing this dissociative state to keep the person divided, that they will never find out what is really going on, what is really the truth. So, warning, to make significant progress towards integration, our whole aim is to get them to integrate. And many times we don't understand the integration, we don't know how it works, and we don't know how to do it. And then we mess up. And so we need to understand how the integration works. One needs to learn to focus on core and avoid getting trapped in all the programming and all the internal structures. The spider webs, the nursery rhymes, all of that stuff. Don't go there. This can lead to distractions and take you down bunny trails. It wastes so much time. The old way of doing DID work was to work with altars. Now, those of you that have come with me for so long and know, I'm so ashamed, but that was my baby shoes, and the Lord, he had grace for me there. And we went down this path, and we tried to do it that way, and we saw it was such hard work. Altars would come forward, and Christian therapists and counsels would then proceed to lead each of those parts to Jesus. And wow, you know, now you've got a witch, then it's a nun. You lead a nun to Jesus, and then it's this one, and then it's that. All the parts that come forward, you must first lead them all to Jesus. Wow, how we worked with altars and wasted so much time. When you lead them to Jesus, you find an internal self-helper to become an internal missionary and say, okay, now you're going to work with us and we're going to work with the family inside. Inside, you've got all the parts. You've got a house and there are many floors and there are many rooms. And you're going to find everybody in the rooms. Now you, as the internal missionary, must now go and find where all these parts are. There's a dungeon. Be careful, there's a dragon. And you work through the whole thing, layers and levels and structures, and we get so caught up with the programming. Note, this does not touch the deeper layers. Like Laurie said, you're only touching the leaves and the branches and maybe going a little bit down the trunk, but you're not getting into the deeper stuff. The deeper stuff we'll only find when it gets to Neshama. So with an SRA survivor, there must be an overall strategy and awareness of the satanic agenda behind what is presenting. There will be programming, internal dynamics, and control constantly acting out. Because remember, they're not supposed to show themselves. So you're trying to, they're coming for help, you're trying to get stuff. And what they'll be pushing, they're throwing out these different parts at you. And what happens if they go to a psychologist that doesn't understand this stuff? And now they've got to be diagnosed. They push out a schizophrenic part. And then the psychologist will say, oh, they're schizophrenic. And they never go deeper. They don't look at that. It's actually just a part of them. And they're tricking you. They're playing games with you. They are trained to play games with you. You've got the programming, you've got internal dynamics and control, because you've got to be in control all the time. You're not allowed to show emotion. You're not allowed to cry. So what do? They absolutely stone-faced. You see nothing. They don't cry at all. There are so many of them that would say, I so want to cry. Please pray with me that I can cry, because I feel I'm going to explode. The emotion inside, but I'm not allowed to show a tear. I'm not allowed to cry. The one said, I would cry inside. The tears would run inside. That's how I learned to cry, was to cry inside. That takes quite a while. You've really got to break down a lot of things and go a long journey before they actually can start to show emotion, because they were never allowed to show emotion. They're constantly acting out and they're just trying to divert you. They're trying to get you go elsewhere. Just don't go near the core. Don't go where the real things are. This is part of the survival strategy. They are telling you that I've just got to survive. This is how I was trained. Nobody was supposed to see and I'm supposed to hide. Now, what are you digging around for? Sometimes you'll have this angry part come forward and shout at you and start swearing. What do you think you're doing? Since you came into our life, you've messed up everything. So you've got to know how to navigate around that. Now, how do we identify core and stay with core? We see here that you must identify Neshama. Okay, so we've done the Neshama teaching. And you've got to now teach them what is Neshama. This is the spiritual cognitive knowing that is deeper than just the brain function. This is now really getting down to the deep levels. And we see teaching survivors what Neshama is a significant change to the length of time to which progress was occurring. If they understand Neshama, you as counselor understand it, you're going to cut a lot of time out. You're going to move a lot quicker getting to the real thing. Again, just a reminder that we did looking at the conscious mind, subconscious mind, the soul, the spirit, and right there is that image of God, that part, that Neshama, where it's the breath of God, the lamp of the Lord. This is just a reminder, it's breath, it's God-created breath of life, it's the God-given capacity to know, perceive life. Neshama is the lamp of the Lord. Proverbs 20 verse 27, it searches the inward parts of man. It gives us life and understanding. Job 32 verse 8, we see that it's going to give us understanding of what they did to this person. We don't understand. We don't know what's happened. But Neshama with God's Spirit knows. Job 33, 4, the Almighty gives us this Neshama, and that gives us life and inspires us. So when they understand that, it's going to give them that extra boost and that extra energy to say, but I'm going to then understand God better, and I'm going to understand myself better. So I'm looking to flow with Neshama. I want to know that. So protocol to stick with core. I've got to know how this works. So the questions. Now, these are the following questions that you will ask a survivor. It's not to get information. In other words, you say to them, listen, I'm not inquisitive. I'm not going to ask you these questions because I'm trying to trick you. Because remember in the cult, they were questioned and nailed the whole time. The whole time. Give me the answers. Give me the answers. Give me the right answers. If they gave wrong answers, they were nailed. They were raped. They were shocked. Whatever it is, they think you're trying to trick them. They watch you. And you say to them, listen, I'm going to ask you questions, but it's not to get information out of you. I'm not a programmer. I'm not interested. I don't want that. I want you to find out about yourself. That's why I'm asking the questions, is to help you, for them to learn and understand what they need to connect with for this journey. I don't want to hurt you in any way. I'm here to help you. And so these are the questions that I'm going to ask. The questions invite the survivor to discover things about themselves that they've been avoiding. They were trained to avoid it. They didn't want to go there. It's horrible to go there. They don't want to go there. With these questions, we're going to help you discover the things that you haven't wanted to discover. So questions empower the victims to see the present day choices and begin to exercise their will. This is so important, because remember, the first 12 years of their life, they've been victims. That's why we don't call them victims. We call them survivors, because they have been labeled as victims. So the first 12 years, this is a biblical principle. In the first 12 years of a child's life, you are under the authority of the father and mother, the parents. And then at the age 13, going into this 13 puberty, embracing the yoke of the kingdom, they do a very big celebration. So this is biblical. Jesus went through it. And it's something that the church should take up again. We've lost it. We go and celebrate the Druids stuff. And we do a 21st birthday and we give a key, which is Druidism. We should go back and do the biblical way. This is now the rites of passage where the psychologists will tell you that the prefrontal cortex of the brain is now starting to work. Biologically, for a child, the front part of the brain, which is the reasoning, which is now I can start making choices. I now stand before God accountable for my choices. This part is now starting to kick in. And what the Jewish families do is they take their children through this whole rites of passage and they do a huge party and they do a big celebration inviting the child into adulthood. Now, we've lost that as the church, but the cult has not. They are very biblical because they want to do the opposite. They want to put in the opposite because they know that there is a pattern of God. This is a pattern. What they would do is now up until age of 12, the child is a victim. There's a switch that takes place. And that is where from a victim, they go through the rites of passage in the cult and now they become a victimizer. It changes. Now they start to victimize other children. They start to kill. They start to be in the role. They get trained and they get trained. So from 13, the 13-year-old is a big key. Because remember the new birth identity that accepted Jesus. From new birth identity up to the age of 12, they're a victim. This is Jesus that rapes them. It's the false Jesus that does all the bad things. So they start to learn to hate God, hate the church. Now they get to 13. So now they say to this rebellious, angry part, you have a choice. Do you agree with Satan that that new birth identity part who accepted Jesus that did that bad move? Because all the trouble you've had was since that little one accepted Jesus. Do you now agree with Satan that that little one should stay dead? And that 13-year-old says, yes. Actively, in her will, in the person's will, they now say, that new birth identity, stay dead. And it's very hard to get that 13-year-old out because she is so protected. Oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. And does not easily come forward. Okay, Doug.
The person, the core person who truly first opened their heart to Jesus Christ, there'll be layers of that. But it's the same person who makes this vow and agreement. The same one. Mm-hmm. And when they make that vow, there's a proxy of them there that looks like that little one that they were. It's an actual cloned representation. They willingly sacrifice. Uh-huh. They put that to death. And what they don't know, that final act of surrendering spirit, soul, and body to Satan at that core adult level creates an event in them over all that. There's conception all the way comes forward, and Satan now they conceive a hybrid. That gives Satan permission to do that, which is so subnormal. They can now conceive a hybrid because that adult core person put to death
has made the choice.
And then from there on out, their mind is, it's a done deal.
Yes. So that 13-year-old is a key because of this major shift and transition that takes place. They don't realize that it's actually still a part of them because this is now the witch. This is now the angry part. This is the rebellious part that hates God, hates Christians, hates the church. Then they get filled with Satan's hate as well. And they just say that they've got such anger and hatred in them, it feels it's consuming them. And then Doug prays and he says, we remove the satanic anger. The anger that is not your anger, human anger, we remove it from you now. Immediately, there's such a release because it's demonically charged, that anger, and they feel they can absolutely kill with Satan's anger. But then, as Doug says, they've made a clone of that little new birth identity. So this 13-year-old does the sacrifice, kills that clone that looks exactly like themselves, and they believe they killed her. And through that, Satan can now come as a father, impregnate them. And that's when they then conceive. They will have their first baby at 12.
And that mother that conceived, and her father as well at the core level, then the mother at 26, there's that which ends up being the wife. But the conceived child, which is a hybrid, then they become the wife.
Yeah.
And that wife becomes one of the most hated and separated and despised because the wife is now joined with Satan by proxy through a hybrid son who represents Antichrist.
Okay, I'm going to explain that to you. It's like Babylon, all right? The whole thing is the order of Babylon. And Babylon is where you have Semiramis and you have Nimrod and you have Tammuz, the sun. It's the mother-child worship. What happens is these girls that are now going to conceive hybrids, they are the royal bloodlines. It's not every one of us that can conceive a hybrid. Are you with me? And that's the mistake where the pendulum went all over to the other side and everybody believes we can all have hybrids. That's nonsense. This is royal bloodlines. What happens is she becomes like a Mother Mary that's going to bring forth an Antichrist, which is now this half-God. This is Hitler's whole story, the half-God, half-human. And he was seeking the Aryan race, apartheid. Us here sitting under the history of apartheid, this was exactly what they were doing. Hitler believed that he wants the superior race. The Afrikaner believed we are the superior race. We're better than the others. The same spirit that Hitler had, we took into our nation, into our Afrikaners, and we started to believe that in apartheid, that we are better than. How come? Because we are half human, half God. He believed going to Mars and that the aliens, the fallen angels came from Mars and then there was this impregnation and we are the super race. I mean, that's the whole Aryan race. That's apartheid. So if any nation in this world has felt the evil, it's our nation through the apartheid and what was going on here with our own people. In the test tube, they are getting the ovum, Anastasia's womb. They're getting the ovum and they're getting a sperm, which is all royal stuff. Now they create this special baby. Overseeing this process is a fallen angel assigned over this whole thing. Of course, it's Satan himself, but there's a fallen angel that oversees this. So he is within every ritual as the child grows. When the child becomes 13... the spirit becomes flesh. That same fallen angel who was there in the beginning now becomes flesh. And she is now pregnant with that fallen angel. Remember, this is the seed of the woman now. She's now conceiving this hybrid. He's half man because he's got her humanity and half spirit, the seed of Satan. Now she's pregnant. This whole thing about Mary, where Jesus became flesh. The same thing. This is a false Mary, a false Jesus. Are you following the picture? Satan can't think up anything. He copies. He's boring. He copies. That same fallen angel that watched over this whole process of this child up until 13 now becomes human. And that's when she gives birth to this hybrid. So she gives birth, and the first son that she gives birth to is Nimrod. It's Babylon. So here's Nimrod. Now she's 13. So how do they work? They work in 13s. So now let's move forward. Age 26. Now that hybrid has grown up into this beautiful being. He's beautiful. He's powerful. And he has got her so addicted to sex. She loves him. He's everything to her. She depends on him. Sally was saying she was so addicted to her hybrid son, but she didn't understand how it works. But she would masturbate 10, 12 times a day. She thought it was normal. Everybody does it. Run to the loo, masturbate. Didn't know that when she masturbates, her son is there. So while she's masturbating, her son is with her. What happens? That power, that energy that she's having sex with her hybrid son channels all the way to Jerusalem and powers up Satan's throne. Can you see? Everything runs on sex. So here at 26, now he's a full-grown man. He doesn't take as long as a human being to grow. She was the mother at 13. She was mother. And then at 26, she now becomes the wife. She now is the wife. The mother will fight for her son. Her whole walk of DID, until this is dealt with, she will fight for her son. Any mother will do anything for her children. Don't you agree? She will fight till the blood flows for her children. That is the love of a mother. That's the bond of a mother. So you've got the mother with the child. This is now the Mother Mary and the Nimrod Jesus. At 26, now he becomes her husband and she's the wife. I mean, this is strong. But now these two are in conflict because the mother loves the son, the baby, the child, and the wife, she's got a husband. Can you see the different parts now developing in the story? So at 26, he becomes her husband. At 39, she conceives another Nephilim son. Again, at stages of 13. So 26 is a big age. 39 is a big age. 52 is a big age. And 65, five seals, the five stars of Satan. And they are sealing every time at those ages. They are sealed into death, deeper and deeper and darker and darker. You become the fullness of the grace of Satan at 65.
And one of the keys about these seals is that the Nephilim that have been conceived and born, there's only going to be one hybrid Christ, false Christ, and a prophet. So all these others that are produced, there will be sacrificed in these seals, and that mother, that wife, in a ritual of the death of a hybrid, while they're being killed, is in necrophilia union. It's a necrophilia sexual union.
Okay, so while he's dying, she's having sex with
the dead hybrid.
Yes.
So it's as gross, this is real. If you don't know about necrophilia in these rituals, they do this. So that's another seal, so we have to pull them out.
There's other, out of death.
I can't go any more there, but that's probably enough
okay.
for now.
Yeah, okay. So do you understand the pattern? I just want you to see it's Babylon. It's this false copycat Mother Mary with Jesus. The false Jesus, the Nimrod. It's Babylon story. So you've got the new birth identity and that gets put to death. Then you've got the 13-year-old that agrees with Satan and kills the clone. Okay, I've killed that naughty one that went to Jesus because since she did that, all this trouble has come my way. So that 13-year-old believes I killed and that one is dead. But I don't know it's part of them because it's core. This is all core. This is core work. So you've got birth, the real person that was born. Then you've got new birth. And now you have 13-year-old. And then you have that mother, then wife. And then you've got all the other seals, which is every time she gives birth to another Nephilim at 39. Doug, if I understand you right, you're saying that she then kills. She sacrifices the hybrid that she gave birth to because that seals her in.
I think to keep this simple, because you're trying to keep track, when you're working with this, with the people, you're at this core level. I just say, okay, when was the last time you were sexually joined as the wife with a hybrid in Jerusalem who represents the current reigning Antichrist?
Okay.
And stay there, unpack that. And who was there still dead on the altar that represents new birth identity? Mm. And you're exalted in this ecstatic union with a hybrid, and behind you, Satan is receiving worship. I'll give you all the kingdoms of this world if you'll bow down and worship me. So the vulnerability of Satan is he's always seeking worship. So who in you was the vessel in this union with a hybrid that last received worship? All these other things are going to be there, but it's the core person who is last joined with the hybrid, representing Antichrist in Jerusalem. That has to be unpacked. Every time you're working with these people, when was the last time the body was joined with the hybrid in Jerusalem? That'll always keep you on track. Because in there, the humiliation and the reinforcement of the death of the new birth identity and the exaltation, Queen of Heaven, they want to keep that Hegelian dialect, core conflict in place, but it's still core fighting against core.
Yes. So every time the person comes for counseling, the first thing you do is, when last were you in contact with a hybrid in Jerusalem? When did you go for sex with a hybrid? And so that will be a core part because you see what they would do to take them to Jerusalem. When they pull them out, they put them into a craft and then they regress them back again to new birth identity, right back to birth and new birth. Because remember, that's where all the trauma is. So when they reinforce that again, that three-way sex, what happens? Escape. The escape is the one that flies away and has sex and wears the ballroom dresses, knows nothing about all that dirty, horrible stuff. I am the queen that gets worshipped because when I go to Jerusalem, that's where I get worshipped. That's where the sex is so good. So you will find that if it's a married couple, you'll find that they're struggling in their sex life. There could be struggles between husband and wife because she's married. She's got another guy. And if it's a single, a lot of them are single girls that don't marry because they're not allowed to get married. So they cry out for men. They cry out for husbands, but they don't get a husband because they are claimed. They're already claimed in the cult to fulfill the wishes of Satan. So a lot of them are single as well. But it's not to say it's a rule. You see, the first 12 years of their life, they've been victims. So what happened? Their will has been destroyed. They have no will. They are slaves. And what you are doing is you are trying to get them to exercise their will, because God will do nothing unless they want help. Unless their will is activated to work with you and with God, nothing will happen. And so the questions are there to help them not to be a victim anymore. You were tricked. You were lied to. So let's find the truth. So let's get your will active. Be aware of the programming. Every survivor has been programmed to throw you off from the right track and to keep things at a surface level and away from their capacity to make authoritative choices. And so they're going to push out all sorts of things at you, try and keep you busy, and then they say no this one and no that one, push different parts forward, and you get so bunny tracked and you can go for hours that you're not working with core at all. They know exactly. What has happened in one of the countries where I said to you, we really feel that we've done a lot of good training. There's counselors that are really raised up and they're doing good work. What happened was they wanted Doug's method. So when they couldn't get a method because he doesn't use a method or a formula, what they would do, and this is what God opened to us on the different trips that we'd been, what the Lord opened up was that these handlers, these programmers, would pre-program the survivors that are coming to the counselors for help. So by the time they walk in, through the night, they've been pre-programmed with all sorts of things. So now they walk in, and where the counseling was flowing, it was going well, suddenly there's a block. And they're saying to me, Manda, please, can you help us? Because we just feel there's a shutdown. We're not getting anywhere. They're just sitting there, and they're saying, we don't know what's going on. They totally shut down. Then we started to realize they've been pre-programmed by the handlers with stuff to try and put the counselors off. And they don't have enough experience to see that. So I said to them, okay, you're going to have to do warfare before the client comes in. And even when the client comes in, you still do warfare and you cut off everything that was pre-programmed to stop this counseling session now. And you clear off all the nonsense that they've put in. Because they pre-programmed, put other programs in and cause such confusion to just lead you off. And then the counselors become despondent. You know, we're not getting anywhere. Since they started to do that and they started to clear off the pre-programmed stuff that was put in place, they started to again move forward. Just remember that they are very well trained. They go to the perpetrators during the night before they come and see you, and a lot of stuff gets done. And you need to clear that off before you're going to get through any work. And then we see often a survivor will only allow parts of themselves to be present that have no real authority or awareness or what is really going on. And so they'll push maybe the child parts. They'll push these parts forward, and now you're sitting there and, okay, what are we going to work with today? They walk out there and nothing's happened. As a counselor, you are frustrated. They are frustrated. Nothing happens because from the back, they are controlling. And this is what makes Doug so angry. When he smells control, he explodes. He doesn't like it. You're not ready. This is what's going on. They'll push these parts forward that don't really, can't really make very strong choices or don't really have authority in the system. So this represents a choice to self-protect over embracing the truth and being honest. And I think, Michelle, when you share with us just now what happened there, because you had to get to a place where you had to choose. Instead of self-protecting, you had to embrace the truth of what's really going on. And that was tough. That was tough. Okay. Further work is often a waste of time and can lead to the survivor playing games. And that is so frustrating. Strong control and an internal need to self-protect puts further work on hold. That's where Doug says, I'm not going further with you. You go and sort this out with God. And when you're ready, you come back to me. It's because they are controlling from the back and they're just pushing these parts forward. They don't really, can't really make much of a choice, can't really change the system. Put everything on hold until the survivor can acknowledge their current choice of self-protection and see they have new choices. They can choose for freedom. Doug always says, okay, break the rules, because they weren't allowed to break the rules in the cult. Another thing is unsafe environment outwardly. For example, Doug always asks us, please find out where the people you're working with, who they're staying with. If they're still staying with the parents who's perpetrating them, I can't help them. I'm not going to see them. I'm wasting my time. And that's why he encourages people to leave their families, to come separated and to work so that they don't stay with the handlers, they don't stay with the perpetrators, because it doesn't help. You're not getting anywhere, you're wasting time. We have a girl, oh man, in the countries there in Europe. This girl is so traumatized, she just sits there. She hardly makes any noises, and then she starts to react all over the place. It is really sad. You pray everything you've ever heard of you pray. You know, you really try and get through, and you talk, and you try. And it's just like, there's nothing. And she's trying so hard, and you see the tears coming up in her eyes and then down, and it's just so, so terrible. And then we found out that she's still staying with her parents, who are pastors of the big church there in her country, and they're perpetrating her. So we're not getting anywhere. So this is a very important one. Your client, where are they staying? And you heard Nadine say that she had to leave everything and make a break and move in with Kim to get help, because it doesn't help to hang around your handlers. The unsafe environment, too much stress in the presenter life can also block the process. So if they're in a very demanding job and taking a lot of their time and putting a lot of stress on them, all the outside stuff can also cause trouble that the process won't go further. There will be an ongoing tendency for the survivor to fall into a victim mindset. Now watch for this. So they want to go back to the first 12 years of their life when they were victim. They want to go back and they push forward the children parts, all the child parts. So there is this tendency for them to go back to the child parts. And the more you can help them see their choices, the consequences, and new choices. In other words, you were tricked. And you can now make new choices. You can choose for Jesus. You can come free. And you help them. That's the coaching that you do. The more the person can be built up to make the harder decisions as the journey progresses. So in the beginning, it's small steps. And then as they get deeper, then they're already learning, but I can make new choices. It also is helpful at certain points for the survivor to ask themselves, why are they wanting counseling in the first place? This is just looking at your own heart, because you see, certain motives will not carry one through to the end. If you just want to get rid of pain, you just want to feel better, you just want these noises to stop, whatever it is, if you've got wrong motives, then you're not going to be able to progress. You're not going to go forward. You are deceiving yourself. And so you need to really stay on track. So the path of less pain, it's very natural to be driven by a desire to reduce internal pain. If this desire is driving the will, then each time a choice arises in counseling and the outcome involves pain, in other words, you've got to embrace the fact that you've been weaponized. Otherwise, we can't go further. You must embrace the fact that you've killed babies. No, it was a part of me. No, I'm not ready for that. The one girl said to me, this is the worst nightmare I've ever heard. You're telling me I've killed babies and I've hurt people. I said, until you embrace that, we can't go anywhere. Because this is how it works in the cult. The volition will follow the path of less pain, even if it means going in circles for years. And that's where some people are stuck. They just will not accept responsibility. They will not accept that they are attacking the church, that they're attacking the body. They don't want to accept that they're weaponized. They don't want to accept the fact they want to stay a victim. Oh, just sitting and crying and crying and crying. Now, that's fine. You've got to deal with those emotions. It's real. But you can't stay there. You must move on to moving into the adult parts that can make choices, that can make decisions so that you can be healed. So be honest and seek a new motive, or you're going to remain stuck. It's not an easy journey. The journey is extremely difficult and in many cases impossible without God's help. And that's when you get to certain places where you just cry out to God and you just say, God, I can't go one step further. I don't know. As counselor, we get there often. Father, I don't have a clue what to do now. I don't know where we're going. And you just cry out to God. Disillusionment will come. The enemy will try and put you off and say, oh, you're wasting your time. But just know, you can help the survivor to know there's always a choice. Remember when Jesus took the cup and he drank the cup, there wasn't a drop left in the cup. And he said, not my will, Father, but let your will be done. What did he do? He drank the cup so that you have the freedom to choose. And you need to remind the survivor. You need to take them to the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus took the cup and he drank the very last drop. There was nothing left in that cup. He laid down his will so that you can take up your will. You can get your will back. Many times they say, but I can't. The devil did this, the devil. Jesus drank the cup. He finished the very last drop. You can. So coach them, to help them, encourage them to know that we can get climbing gear. We can get better shoes from the Lord. It's amazing what Jesus does along the way. He is amazing. And he meets everyone where they are at. And he is just so amazing. There are times when you need to be confrontational and spell it out to the survivor where their choices are leading them and what their boundaries and what your boundaries are. And that's what Kim was sharing. She had to put down certain boundaries. Laurie was saying there are days that she says, look, I can't see you today. I've got to have time with God. As the survivor is watching you, they're learning healthy boundaries as well. Hey, but I can say no. Because they were a slave. They never were allowed to say no. But now you help them to live life. Questions. Are you willing to work with a survivor more dedicated to self-protection than truth? So we know here, we're not going to work with somebody who is rather hanging on to self-protection than truth. One who's saying they want to know God but is constantly involved in idolatry and lying about it. In other words, every night going and having sex. You're doing rituals, going out and doing rituals. So who are you committed to? As a counselor, are you prepared to walk with a person who's continuously going into idolatry? We've got to help them because there are parts that are programmed to go that are triggered. They need to start making the healthy choices. And Doug always tells the survivors to say, listen, ask God to wake you up. When they come in to trigger you and to take you out for the night, ask God to wake you up. It's your journey to get there. It's not going to be immediate, but it's a fight. They must learn to get their will active and to say, no, I'm not. And call upon the name of the Lord. Call upon the name of the Lord. And we've had survivors that wake up calling Jesus, and they drop down onto the bed. As they were ready to take them out on the UFO, God got through, and they cried out, Jesus, and they fell back onto their bed. It is possible. God will help you. But you've got to help them get out of the slave mentality of, I can't choose, I don't have a choice. No, Jesus finished the cup. Jesus finished the cup. We don't want to carry on with idolatry, people that are in idolatry, one who only wants to acknowledge being a victim, pushing out their little ones and crying and crying and crying. But they're saying, I've never hurt anyone in my whole life. But 70% of their life is they did hurt. But they don't want to acknowledge that. This is what I'm saying. I spoke about it yesterday. God pressed it on my heart to say, please, if you're a survivor, embrace the fact that you've been a victimizer, that you are weaponized. You're not going to get better until you accept that. Otherwise, you stay in idolatry and you stay being a victim. So that's our question. You cannot teach another boundaries if you don't have them yourself. And that's for the counselor.
What I want to say is, I bless you, Amanda.
Thank you, Doug.
Never. This has never happened in the United States. Never. Tom Horn, L.A. Marzulli, Rusted, they all know who I am. Okay? They all know. They're digging up bones. I don't have a problem with that. Finding skulls, going back in ancient history, proving all this happened. But when it comes to the witnesses, coming to something like this, they won't touch it. Why? Because the testimonies of you people, that doesn't have the same evidence as a bone. And every fact shall be established on the basis of two or three witnesses. We have the facts. So you can pray that if God wants something like this to happen in America, it will. But the first time ever it's going to happen in America, for some reason, it's in Hawaii. This is first. First. The United States is the daughter of Babylon. Jeremiah 50, verse 12. You shall be the hindermost of nations. Who's the subject twice in Jeremiah 50 and 51? Twice you have the reference to the daughter of Babylon. There's ancient Babylon, there's the daughter. You shall be destroyed. Well, it wasn't destroyed in Jeremiah's day. So who is the daughter of Babylon? You compare Isaiah 47, Jeremiah 15, 51, and Revelation 18. And what other nation fits that like the United States? So as the lightning flashes from the east to the west, so shall the return of the Son of Man be. The westernmost boundaries of the daughter of Babylon is Hawaii. And that boundary is broken. It's going to increase the legal criteria between God and Satan for him to return from his church. And the girl we'll be working with, programmed with seven hybrids, is a real key. 6 months, mainly just aberrations, releasing neshama, and then she could talk. I haven't seen any of the separate parts. It's just unbelievable. So what am I saying? Thank you. I mean, nowhere have I seen anyone present PowerPoint. I don't do PowerPoints. I say, I'm it. You know. So she has to take it and put it all down. I think she'll receive a really big hand. Thanks for what she's done. Because no one has given any kind of a conceptual framework. And people have asked me, I can't tell me, oh, when are you going to write a book? I don't know how to write a book. I really don't. And so, Amanda, this is as close as you can get. So I bless you. And if God wants this to be extended anywhere else, it's going to be a God event because there's a huge veil over the continental United States. But I have to tell you this. Russ Dizdar, he is such a gem. He knows. He knows that the whole hybrid breeding program goes back to Germany. But he got nailed one time with L.A. Marzulli. Somebody stood up, who are the Nephilim mothers? And they got, oh, well, we're out of evidence. And so L.A. Marzulli goes on for bones for the next 3 years. So they're all great guys. Okay, I can't help from laughing because I love these guys. All right, so here's Russ. He interviews one of his mentors, Holly Hector, PhD psychologist at Centennial Hospital, I think in Denver, where they have a psych ward, and she's been doing this 30 years, and Russ interviews her, and Russ says, yeah, we go get the evidence, and you know what Holly said? I got the evidence sitting in front of me every day.
Sure.
And so, pray for thank us, you, Amanda. Dad.
Oh, yeah. That's such a blessing. Will you pray,
yes.
Please?
Father, we want to thank you for this time and for the Lord Jesus Christ, the second man, so wonderful, like Amanda said. You're so wonderful, Lord. Release the remaining part of your blessing for this time. You just cover just the very shalom of God. Lord Jesus, you are shalom in the flesh, shalom in the spirit. You are the life of our life. You're the heart of our heart. So bless these children, Lord, and all those that are suffering. We invite you, Lord Jesus Emmanuel, into that place where they most don't want to see. You're already there. You never left. You've never left. So your blessing upon these people and your guidance over this time. Oh, Lord, we bless you. We bless you. Son of God, Son of Man, Son of Man. The exalted man. God-man. The one who is way beyond anything that a Satan could produce as a hybrid. The God-man. Forever. You can't go back. You are both man and God in one person forever. We bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.